We are all recovering from something. A childhood. No childhood. A mother. No mother. An idea of ourselves that no longer fits. An attachment to someone or something that doesn't love us back. A song that hurts our ears but which we can't stop playing. A place in the body where we were broken. A place in the soul where we were twisted. A place in our story left blank. We are all recovering from something. Our recovery is a testament, a benediction, a prayer that reads, "Dear God, dear everyone, I am." Here I am, spending my first holiday with Mom and Dad since the divorce. Here I am, 16 years old, and I think, I know what I want to do with my life. I am going to be a model. Mama gets out the want ads and finds it there in black and white. My first job paid in product and experience. I step onto the runway, snake hips and speakers pumping, bomb, bomb, chicka-chicka. My hair lacquered into a stiff fan running ear to ear. I am a goddess of 1980s glam, standing on a box in a neoprene skirt and a fiberglass bustier, blinded by floodlights, cameras flashing and thousands applauding. Mama and Daddy together again in the audience, together again in the dark. Together, again. Outside it rains and I worry, what will happen to my lacquer job? I want to keep it always. I want to fly it to the moon. This is my forever radio station. This is my lantern in the dark. Mark a new place in time because nothing will be the same after today. Oh, I am rotten now. I will have to be dragged off stage. The ivory beat of my half-blood heart starts and stops with every bomb, bomb, chicka-chicka. Surely, this will fix me. Fix my broken laugh and my windstorm eyes. Fix these lies. Fix the coat with the missing button and the curling iron that rusted. Fix the days I cried and didn't know why. Fix my father with his piles of paper covering every surface in the house. Fix this family. Fix what could not be broken. Fix this thing inside me that feels like a bomb about to go off. At some point, Mama sends a picture of me to a photographer for Hustler magazine. This photographer says he would give me $10,000 to pose for a shoot. I think about what I could do with $10,000. Daddy thinks about something else, something appropriate, and I do not do a shoot for Hustler magazine. But I don't blame Mama. She was just trying to get me what I wanted. She says she could be my manager. She says we could be famous. Surely this will fix me. Then I wake up one morning, and she's gone. But I don't blame Mama. How could you blame someone who isn't there? Instead, I blame my father. I blame my brother and my sisters. I blame society. I blame Hollywood. I blame my mother's boyfriends and my father's girlfriends. But most of all, I blame myself. The Christmas tree stays up until July that year. Needles turn brown and fall down to the carpet. You can't pick them up without cutting your fingers. Another day, another bottle of hairspray, and one too many glasses of champagne. I find myself in the back of another hair salon, bent over the toilet, blown out in a whole new way. Bomp, bomp, ch-ch-ch, ugh. I didn't know. I was recovering, surviving, the only way I knew how. Like a creature digging a hole to hide in, not knowing I was digging into my own self, not knowing the way out. I heard a woman say she had a hole too. We are all recovering from something, from taking care of everyone but ourselves, from tears that water everything. From the inside outness, the unexpected guilt and everything after missing the chance to see how the light shines through the cracks, not into us, but out of us, even when we are headlong down a dark hole, even when we run. I thought, a good mother wouldn't run from Hollywood to Nashville to Vegas, anywhere dangerous, anywhere bright, anywhere possibilities are endless, where people risk it all and come out winning or dying. We are all or nothing. We are up against a wall. We are counting the beats while the numbers fall. We are swimming in smoke and air-conditioned air in a maze of lights where you are supposed to get lost. But then, a good daughter doesn't get thirsty when she hears the dealers calling the shots and the players rolling the dice, how they scream when they win and they scream when they lose, and the place reeks of booze. I haven't had a drink in almost 9 years. All that blow. Vicodin, Valium, Xanax, pot, but not a single drop of liquor. I had quit drinking in college after a series of unfortunate nights, which I could not really remember. But look, I don't black out anymore. I don't throw up. I don't slur my words, and I certainly don't need any help. I carry denial on my back like a wrecked semi. Everyone sees me coming, my neck wrenched, my jaw clamped, my heart. Where is my heart? I am an abyss where no call can reach me. I am the cliff I have jumped off of, a hollow scrag of rock, the promise of death. One morning, sneaking in at dawn, I walk past a mirror and I see this ragged doll whose hair stretches across its face, naked and bony. I'd ruined and wasted. I turn away. When I turn back, I know it is me. Then, one night, I met a cowboy at a gas station. He told me all about how he had quit drinking and drugs, too, and these meetings that he went to, and I told him all about how my boyfriend was moving out. So when he stopped returning my phone calls, I went to those meetings looking for him. Instead, I found me. So it was stalking that got me sober. I, at this point, haven't had anything stronger than coffee in what seems like a lifetime and is actually about a year. But I still blame Mama. I blame her for leaving me behind. I blame her for every single time she was out chasing her own stars and not watching them with me. I blame her for her lies, which she likes to call stories, but which are lies. I blame her for telling me too much, for my father's broken heart. I blame her every time I cry, and I have only begun. I've only begun to feel it now that I'm not high. I blame her. A good mother would have come back for me like she promised. A good mother would not take her teeth out in public. A good mother would most definitely not ask for a full glass of maraschino cherries to dump into her brandy Manhattan as she jerks her rascal into the casino with one hand, cocktail glass in the other. A good mother would not call out to a handsome stranger as he passes by, "This is my daughter, isn't she pretty? She's a movie star and she's single, if you can believe that." "Well, what's the matter? I'm gonna find your husband now. Don't you trust me?" A good daughter would speak her truth. A good daughter would tell her everything. How I envy my best friend Jackie, how I'm getting older and it scares me, how she's getting older and it scares me. I want to be real. I want to be seen, most of all by Mama. I just don't know how to change the way we've been for so long. I'm not even sure it's possible or who I would be without that. A good daughter would speak her truth, but I say nothing. And the moment passes. All the time, we are becoming, recalibrating, recovering. What if today is the day? What if we all joined hands and just said yes? Do you remember a time when you saw elephants in the clouds, it chased fireflies in the gloaming, how you danced naked under the light of the moon? Oh, okay, maybe you weren't naked, that was me. Maybe it was raining. Yes, I remember now, it was raining. My words come out in bursts, in sobs, regret, and loss I can't hold on to any longer. I am insolent, grotesque, the evidence of my sorry soaked into my sleeves. My mother asks, who is this? I'm lost. I tell her, you left me. I tell her, I never got over it. I wait. I expect promises funeralizing the only doctrines she is possessed of. Instead, there is a close-fitting quiet. She listens. She doesn't cry. She doesn't even try to tell me a story. She says all the right things. She says, I was going to come back for you, and things changed. She says, I did what I thought was best for you. She says, if we get another lifetime as mother and daughter, but I tell her, I'm pretty sure there are no do-overs for that. I am who I am, and I blame you for it. It was my father who taught me to thine own self be true, but it was my mother who forged that truth with fire, with heartbreak, with two silver spoons and the palm of her hands. It was my mother who taught me that magic is not only real, it is the only thing that matters. I am this body, primitive as ice and brighter than the sun. I am all the changes I made so that you could love me and all the lessons I learned along the way. I am the strongest person I know. I am brave in the small moments when someone needs to hear the truth. I am the room where the blue sky hides at night. And for that, I blame you, Mama. I am the fruit of your memories and the stories that make you. I am your impossible, your miracle, your starlight, star bright, first star I see tonight. Glowing at the end of the tunnel like a torch. Turn me on and let me lead the way. I am your conscience and your grit, your seed to shining sea, your skyscrapers and your stepchildren, your dancer with one leg, dancing a dance without steps. I am your dreams and your bones, inventing and reinventing. You're fallen, you're wounded, you're never giving up. I am your baby girl, Mama. And you are all I've ever had.
Please welcome back the founders of She Recovers and the She Recovers Foundation, Don Nickel and Taryn Strong.
Amazing, wasn't that something? Dufflyn Lammers! Besides being an awesome actress, she's also a dear member of our community, and she's a She Recovers coach in Paris as well.
Well, Taryn and I are really, really honored and excited to welcome you here to this evening's program. We are so excited about this. Oh, I don't want to start crying already. What the heck?
It seems late.
I know. Thank you, everybody, for being here this weekend. You know, it's just been absolutely heart-opening from the very moment that we started yesterday. I want to thank all of our amazing presenters that you've spent time with today, our speakers. There's much to come yet, but I have to say that we've really been looking forward to the gala. Once we figured out how to say gala, we vacillate.
Gala,
you know, Mackenzie, Phillips, and I and Taryn were doing a Facebook Live. We were in Mexico in May. And I think we spent about 5 minutes on the Facebook Live. Is it gala? Is it gala? Is it gala? So, tonight it's gala. We have a really exciting and fairly condensed program for you. I know that everybody is really excited to get out into the Wilshire Garden where we had our welcome reception on Friday night. We're doing a silent disco.
Peyton's idea.
Yeah, Peyton's idea. She wants you to know that. And I also just wanted to remind everybody that Shame Booth, our beautiful Shame Booth partners here, have created a beautiful listening experience in the room that is at the end of the hall where we just had the red carpet set up. So tomorrow, if you're feeling a little bit like you want some quiet time, I invite you to go in and enjoy the beautiful cushions and the setting that they've created. It's just absolutely magical. And you can listen to a project that we collaborated with Paula and her team on. We had many of you and other women in recovery from whatever they're recovering from call in and leave a message to their former selves. And so that is what the Listening Experience Lounge is about. So we invite you to make sure that you check in on that tomorrow, please. And Paula, thank you. It's beautiful.
Thank you.
So you know how things go, right? Where sometimes you think, well, we're going to do this, that, the other, and then 40,000 other things by September 14th, 2018. Yeah. Maybe that's the problem. I'm a century behind. One of the things that we really hoped was going to happen by this evening was that we hoped that we were going to be able to announce that we are now, so we're not, so don't clap, that we are now an official 501c3. We are not. We are, however, a nonprofit formed earlier this year called the She Recovers Foundation. And we're, yeah. And the lovely lawyer who we're working with, actually, this week I said, hey, I can get you that 1023, which is the application for the charitable status. I'll get that to you this week, meaning like this week that just passed. People are in denial from a lot of things around here, I'll tell you. So that was me. So that didn't happen. But we do look very forward to, by the end of this month, submitting our application, and we hope that it'll go through fairly quickly. And in the meantime, we have set up our foundation page, the She Recovers Foundation. So you can visit on our website and you can watch for when it is launched. You can sign up for the newsletter that will be specific to the foundation. And we're going to ask for your support. And we don't just mean money, although we do mean money too. If anybody has an extra $5 here or there, that would be great. The purpose of this foundation is, I want to say, threefold. Not everybody has been able to access our offerings to date. We do retreats in Mexico and in Bali, on beautiful Salt Spring Island on the West Coast. We've done one in California in a place called Templeton. Nobody in California has ever heard of Templeton. We do workshops, and we've done one-day workshops in Atlanta, Los Angeles, San Francisco, Victoria, and Seattle. And we have done an event like this in New York City last year. How many of you were in New York City last May? So these are just some of our event offerings. What we really want to work towards as a foundation is offering a great, much wider variety of offerings that are more accessible for more women. So we want to do free things. We want to do one-day workshops. We want a speaker series. We want to do all sorts of event things so that we can invite more women into our community, provide much more access, and really increase diversity in our community. So that's some of the focus. As part of that, this idea about greater access to our philosophy in large part, but also to our offerings, we're going to be starting grassroots groups in communities. So the proper language for that in a nonprofit is chapters. So we will be starting official nonprofit chapters. But because we didn't know that chapters were only supposed to be nonprofit, we started a bunch of them before. So I would actually like to, if I may, Kelly, are you here? Kelly Beck? She's here somewhere. Please, Kelly? Kelly Beck is the coordinator of our Seattle chapter of She Recovers. Leanna Kennedy, are you here? Leanna Kennedy is the coordinator of our Victoria, British Columbia. We are an international organization, after all, Victoria, British Columbia. And Nikki Coleman is not here, but she is our Atlanta chapter lead. So, yeah, thank you. I want anybody in Southern California to know that, so that's kind of the old guard where we kind of called things chapters that weren't supposed to be called chapters. Before we actually go forward and start calling things what they're supposed to be, we have this interim period where we're going to be starting meetups, so local meetups. So is Kirsten Newquist here? Kirsten is here. Kirsten? Kirsten has started. Yeah. Kirsten has started our very first meetup. It's called the Southern, it's She Recovers Southern California Pilot Meetup. If you call things pilot, you don't get in trouble if you did it wrong, right? So for those of you who are living in Southern California, please do have a look on the Meetup app and look for She Recovers Southern California, and you can partake in the event. So these are the events that are extremely accessible. In Southern California, they've been doing yoga on the beach. In Victoria, we hold sharing circles once a month, and the same in Seattle. And, you know, it's just gathering. There's no charge for these events. Women are asked if they're able to donate to pay for the space if there is a cost associated with the space. So we're really looking forward to growing and expanding, scaling what this is. You know, we've said this a few times this weekend, but our motto or our tagline, we have a lot of taglines, is we're really all about connecting, supporting, and empowering women. And we just want to keep doing that. So we look forward to receiving your support as we move forward. And your support means just continuing to engage in our community, online, in our groups, on our page. You know, we just ask that you continue to tell people that there is a way that women can connect to a philosophy that is inclusive in its philosophy. We are all recovering from something. This is not at all just about substance use disorder. And so we really do appreciate your support, all the support that we've been given in the 7 years since we launched this baby, and we look forward to continued support.
So one of the missions that we're going to want to be doing with these community-driven incentives is, as a lot of you have experienced this weekend, is the power of making connections online and then those in-person connections as well. So I know some of you, of course, didn't know anybody when you came, and a lot of you may have known each other from your social media outlets. And then you really can't compare what it's like to meet in the first time. Somebody who has supported you on your journey and your recovery and your healing, who you haven't met in real life, and then having that opportunity to meet in person is just so powerful. And we just want to create that for as many women as we can.
We want to heal the world one woman at a time, or at least play our part in it.
Yes.
So thank you very much, and before we leave, we would just really like to thank the Hollywood Foreign Press for everything. Thank you.
Can I introduce me
now? Now you can introduce me.
Okay. All right. Who here has heard of Amy Dresner? So Amy Dresner, for those of you who haven't clapped, which was nobody, of course, is a columnist for The Fix. She used to be a female stand-up comedian. And of course, she's the author of our favorite memoir, My Fair Junkie, a memoir about getting dirty and staying clean. So please help me welcome Amy Dresner.
I was a female stand-up comedian, not a male stand-up comedian, despite the fact that many people think I could have been a man because of my voice. So I thought I was going for a 70s supermodel, but do I look like a genie? Be honest. I was just on the edge, right? On the edge. Right? Like water, this, you know, just 900 notes. A little nervous. It's okay. This has been amazing, right? And emotional. Very emotional, right? I had like a total meltdown last night, crying. But here I am, and I'm supposed to be like, beacon of recovery, so let's talk about that. I am Amy Dresner. I'm a drug addict, and I'm an alcoholic, and I'm a sex addict, and a love addict, and a nicotine addict, and a caffeine addict, and a nap addict. I also wrote a memoir called My Fair Junkie, and I know you're not supposed to say junkie or addict anymore. The correct PC term is substance use disorder. But I just didn't think that My Fair Girl with Substance Use Disorder was gonna fly off the shelves, you know what I mean? So. I don't know. I don't think anybody has the right to tell you how to tell your own story. Oh, well, junkie and addicts are reverent. I got news for you. Addictions are reverent. So, I grew up a spoiled brat in Beverly Hills, and now I'm back here. Great. I went to school with all the celeb kids while my dad wrote schlocky sitcoms and my mom was off in Mexico weaving rugs. So my dad made a bet with me. He said, Ames, I'm gonna make a bet with you. I bet you'll smoke or drink or do drugs before you're 18. And I said, I bet I won't. He said, I'll bet you $1,000. And that's how Jews raise each other. We just bribe each other. It worked. It worked. I waited till I was 19 till I drank. So, I'm 19, I drank, and I had my first nervous breakdown. I've had 4 nervous breakdowns. It's like a hobby of mine at this point, really. You know, I like to have one every decade. Keeps things interesting. Keeps people on their toes. I've suffered from depression from as long as I can remember, and I've been on the merry-go-round and round and round, you know, Prozac, Effexor, Provigil, Lithium, Zyprexa, Paxil, you name it. At 24, I stumbled on methamphetamine, and I was like, I don't care if this stuff is made with gun bluing and Drano. I've never felt better in my life. Like, hello. Prozac with wings, come on. So. Any tweakers here? Woo! That's right. I was a crafty tweaker, you know? Like collaging, a lot of collaging. Refinishing furniture at 4 in the morning. Dumpster diving. You know, plucking my eyebrows for 9 straight hours, right? I stayed up for 17 days once, and I wrote a new Bible based on Emerson and Nietzsche. So, you know, I thought I had the mathematical equation for God. So I was doing really productive stuff, is what I'm telling you guys, okay? Anyway, one night I walked into a market, and I woke up in an ambulance, and I'd had a grand mal seizure. And the EMT said to me, ma'am, did you do any drugs tonight? And I said, obviously some really shitty ones, because here I am. So I had about 12 more grand mal seizures, and then I was diagnosed with epilepsy from crystal meth. Woo! But I still have all my teeth, you guys, and that's what matters. It's L.A. I know that She Recovers is not just for people recovering from addiction. It's also for people recovering from eating disorders and mental illness and trauma and cutting and sexual abuse and people recovering from recovery meetings, right? So, I've had all that too, so I've got all you ladies covered. Don't worry about it. You know, in my addiction, I did everything I swore I'd never do, right? That's the nature of addiction, right? I had sex with strangers in the back of my car. They were like 20 and like 20 years old, like half my age, and probably 20 of them as well. I mean, it was a Volkswagen with leather seats and a sunroof. It's not that embarrassing, I guess. It could have been a trashier car, but I drove drunk. I drank Four Locos. Do you guys know what Four Locos are? Oh, well, if you go into any nice establishment like a 7-Eleven or a gas station, classy joints. It is a premium malt liquor that is 12% alcohol, and it's the equivalent to 5 beers and 4 cups of coffee. Yeah. The big thing I never thought I'd do is intravenous drug use, and I did go there. I shot cocaine. I just want to give you my... in my defense, I'm going to explain my thinking around when I started shooting drugs. Well, my nose was bleeding, so I just couldn't get any more cocaine up there, pretty much. And I really thought, well, you know what? I think that shooting up is like an efficiency thing. Like, if you had to go to Uruguay, think about it. You're going to Uruguay. Would you take a rickshaw or a rocket? Let's get to where the fuck we're going, you know what I mean? Okay. I want to give you a window into my insanity. I'm shooting cocaine, and at this point, I have epilepsy, and you can have a seizure shooting cocaine even if you don't have epilepsy. Right, Mac? Where's Mac? I think Mackenzie will. Right, Mac? Yeah. That's true, right? Yeah, Mac will back me up on that. So it's super. When you have epilepsy, man, shooting coke and having a seizure is like a sure shot. So I shot coke, and I would have a seizure, and I'd shoot coke and have a seizure, and then I had a moment of clarity. And I was like, shooting coke is a high-impact sport, you guys. I need to wear protective gear. So I started shooting cocaine in a bike helmet. Hey, it made sense at the time. Judge away. It made sense at the time. I have a very impressive resume. 6 rehabs, 4 psych wards, 3 suicide attempts, obviously unsuccessful. Looking for a nice husband, so if any of you ladies know someone, Psych wards are interesting, aren't they? It's like, let's take someone who's incredibly depressed and put them in the most depressing place on the planet with no windows and terrible food and people that think they're Thomas Jefferson, you know? I mean, when you're in a green gown, everything you say sounds crazy. I was like, they told me this was a spa. That's why I brought my bathing suit. I'm afraid that my cat's not eating. Did he tell you that? I was a chronic relapser for 20 years. And I could not stay sober, and I could not get out of my own way. And I had this idea that I was broken, and that people should take care of me. I lived off a trust fund, and when that was gone, I married a rich guy. I do not suggest that. I thought he could fix me, and he's going to take care of me. And I didn't think I could take care of myself, and I didn't want to, because I was crippled, and I was broken, and I was special. And all that came crashing down on December 25th of 2011, when, high off my face on OxyContin, I pulled a knife on that rich guy. And he called the cops, and I got arrested for felony domestic violence with a deadly weapon. And I went to jail. Boy, my parents were proud. I remember when the sheriffs were handcuffing me, and they began to read me my rights, and I slurred, "Law and Order is my favorite show. Like, I know the drill, you guys." I vaguely remember calling an old sponsee from West Hollywood jail, and she'd become a bail bondswoman. And she was like, "Oh my God, Merry Christmas, my old sponsor, Amy. How are you?" It's like, "Hi, I'm in jail." So I lost everything, and it was the best thing that ever happened to me, truly. I believe you meet your destiny on the road you go to avoid it, you know? And I didn't want to take care of myself. And the universe was like, "Really? You don't want to take care of yourself, huh? Okay." I was given a year of domestic violence counseling and 240 hours of community labor. That's not community service, you guys. That's not sitting on your ass folding shirts at the out of the closet, okay? This is community labor. This is sweeping trash on the streets on a chain gang. So I remember the first day I showed up for community labor. I was like, "Oh my God." It's like, "Oh my God, these people are criminals. Like, I'm a Jewish American princess from Beverly Hills." You know? And it was like 40 Mexican guys and me. And they were like, "What you here for, Weta? Huh? I'm here for a DUI. And I was like, "Oh, I'm here for felony domestic violence with a deadly weapon." They were like, "Oh shit, nobody screwed with me." I was one of the only people there for violent assault, and I had more time assigned to me by the court than anyone else. Hi, humility! So they handed me a broom, and they said, you've swept before, right? And I said, well, I've swept privately. I've never swept publicly. I'm more of a private sweeper, like the Tina Turner song, you know? So not amused by me, ever. But instead of being ashamed of my new time on the chain gang, I started documenting it on Facebook. And I would print, I would share pics of stuff I saw on the street and like poignant moments and weird things that I learned. And that's how I deal with my shame. I flip it. I own it completely and just show everyone. And then no one has anything on you, you know? And people loved it and they laughed. Thank you. What are people gonna say? I heard you tried to stab your ex-husband. It's like, yeah, I wrote a book about it. What else you got, you know? Next. So I was, it was, I wasn't proud of what I'd done, but I couldn't change it, and I decided not to be ashamed of it, and I owned it. And when I finished my community labor, people were like, get arrested again, that was hilarious! I remember there was a semi-celeb, the other girl on there, and she was on a reality show, and she was, I found her tweet for the day, and she said, just finished hiking for eight hours with underprivileged children. Really? Is that what you'd call it? So it was 8 hours sweeping trash in the hot sun. And I felt really sorry for myself in the beginning. I was like, poor me, I'm a victim. You know, I'm cursed. Why is this happening to me? And then I had an epiphany. And I was like, this can be the best thing that ever happened to me. Or this can be the worst thing that ever happened to me, and it's my choice. You know? I was like, Amy, this is the consequences of your decisions, all your actions. Maybe there's lessons here. Maybe there's gifts here. You know? Get a suntan. Get some good biceps. Humility. Work ethic. Learn teamwork. So, you know, I mean, I can sweep, God, if you guys, any of you guys want me to come sweep your porch, I am good. I am really good. So, Will Rogers said, you know, the worst thing that happens to you can be the best thing for you if you don't let it get the best of you. And that's the second thing in my book. And the first thing is, this book is dedicated to anybody who thinks it's too late. Because as long as you're alive, it's just never too late. I mean, I'm 48 years old! I don't know why I do that dumb voice. I'm really sorry. So how did I transform from epic fuck-up into semi-fuck-up that's here? I have no idea, but I'm going to tell you some of my secrets. Shh, don't tell anybody these secrets, okay? I had a sponsor who told me, you don't have to be a good person. You just have to act like one. Nobody knows the difference. And that's the truth. You're being judged on your actions. You're not being judged on your intentions. No one cares about your intentions. And so I used to be very about my truth. And so I started to act like the person I wanted to be, no matter how I felt. And if you do that over and over and over again, you actually create a new neural pathway in your brain, and that becomes the new default, and that becomes you. It's neuroscience. Not just pretty, but smart, too. My father said to me like 20 years ago, he goes, stability doesn't create discipline. Discipline creates stability. And I was like, I don't even know what that means. What that means is that a structured, routine life will make you feel stable inside. If you're waiting to feel okay before you go to the gym, keep that appointment, write that book, get sober, you're waiting forever. But if you do it, you take the action, it changes the feelings. I'm so thrilled to be here tonight at She Recovers. We have so many groundbreakers. in the audience and on stage. Tarana Burke, who founded the Me Too movement. To speak up against sexual violence. Mackenzie Phillips, the actress who wrote an extremely brave memoir, High on Arrival, and been very, very vocal about her recovery. And Laurie, Dhue, the TV journalist who's been a recovery activist, as well as a voice against sexual harassment. Susan Ford Bales, whose mother, Betty Ford, was the first lady to speak openly about her alcoholism and the battle with breast cancer. I'm hoping I didn't offend her too much, because I'm sure she has some ties to the government. She could have me sent to Cuba or something like that. So, you know, if I get pulled off by security, that's what happened. Hi, Susan. I have no idea what I'm doing up here. Someone told me that my book, My Fair Junkie, was groundbreaking in its humor and its insight and its rawness, and thank you, but I still don't know what I'm doing here. Humor, let's talk about that for a moment. Don't take yourself so goddamn seriously. For real. Tragedy plus time equals comedy. And it's like, if you can laugh at it at the time, all the better. Like, the way if I couldn't have laughed at some of that stuff, I couldn't have gotten through it, for real. Like, find the humor in it and just move on. I've heard some people say that I was unlikable in my book. Especially in the beginning. You know, I to that I say, you know, if you're likable when you're mentally ill and on drugs, like, why get sober? Right? It's like, if you're trying to look good in an addiction memoir, you're not being honest enough. You know, readers have written to me and they're like, you know, that my book has given them hope, which is great. You know, to turn 20 years of hell and self-destruction into a tool that's given people hope is a dream. You know? I haven't had a date since the book was published, but I'm an old cat lady, and that's fine, but I've given strangers hope, so who cares, right? If I ever get laid again, it's fine. You know. I've also, people written to me and like, thank you. Just thank you for keeping it real, you know? Thank you for making me feel less broken and less alone. And what I heard was, wow, you were bad, you know? So I now have 5.5 years sober. I guess I'm a speaker now, I guess. I'm a published author, I'm a columnist, and I'm a proud recovering addict. Getting sober was the hardest thing I ever did, over and over and over again. And somehow I went from pariah to example to inspiration, and so can all of you. I'm not special. Back when I celebrated 3 years for the 14th time, I asked my father if he was ashamed of me when he spoke to his friends. And he said, my friends wish they had a kid as unbreakable as you.
Hi, my name's Tarana Burke, and I'm the founder of the Me Too movement. We founded Me Too over a decade ago to support young women of color in the community we live who are survivors of sexual violence. In the years since we started, we've expanded to support adults and people across the gender spectrum who have been holding the trauma of sexual violence for many, many years. Now, since the expansion or explosion of Me Too in 2017, we have a unique opportunity to expand our platform and continue a national conversation around sexual violence in this country and countries around the world. But we want to be clear about what the Me Too movement is about. There's lots of conversation about it being about taking down powerful men or about targeting people, and it's not about any of those things. This is a movement about giving people access to a healing journey to make sure the most marginalized amongst us have an opportunity to start a pathway to healing from the trauma of sexual violence. It's also a movement about radical community healing. We believe that communities have to come together to make them safe and to protect the most vulnerable people from sexual violence. We do this through two ideas. One is called empowerment through empathy. We believe in the power of empathy to support people. When two people exchange the words Me Too, it is literally an exchange of empathy between people that says, I hear you, I see you, and I believe you. Once people have that, it gives them permission to start a healing journey. And that's what we're about. The other idea is radical community healing. And that means that in all the ways that sexual violence is allowed to flourish in our communities, we want to work against that. Ultimately, this is a movement about eradicating sexual violence. We want to teach people how to lean into their joy so that they can move away from the trauma. And we want to teach people that we can, as a collective, interrupt sexual violence wherever it lives. And we want to do that together. We need everybody doing all the work they can and all the ways they can to interrupt sexual violence. And we invite you to join us.
Please welcome award-winning national news anchor, one of this nation's leading recovery advocates, a certified recovery specialist, and strategic advisor to She Recovers, Laurie Dhue.
Boy, you women look gorgeous tonight. You do. Clean up nice. Really nice. See, I'm trying to be funny now because Amy was just up here. And it's like, okay, Laurie, just leave that to the funny people and... Thank you for one person left. But I feel no shame. So you will recall that Tarana Burke, who we just heard from a moment ago, was among of a group of other activists known as the Silence Breakers, who received the Time Magazine Person of the Year Award last year. Breaking the silence was everything. I like what Tarana said in that short video. She said, it's an exchange of empathy, helping people learn to lean into their joy so they can move away from their trauma. And that's what Me Too is all about, and that's what recovery is all about. It's working our way through things and not around things, which I talked about this morning. It's about digging deep, even if it's painful, and digging deep because it's painful. And that's okay. Dealing with the pain and then letting go and then receiving the joy and the gifts that follow. Cheryl Stray had touched on this last night. Remember the five things she talked about towards the end of her speech last night? One of them was, it's important for us to take risks. It's important for us to actually be vulnerable because most of us will end up saying, me too. So me too is a whole lot more than a hashtag. It is a movement. And as I mentioned during my keynote this morning, I was a national news anchor for many years at several different networks, one of which got an awful lot of attention in 2016 and 2017 for sexual harassment. I received my fair share of utterly terrible treatment while at that network. I wish I could say more about my experience, but upon the advice of my attorney, I've been told to shut it right there. So, with that said, I am particularly grateful to be up here. Wish I could say more. But I'm so grateful, with that said, to be up here to tell you about the She Recovers Foundation Hope Award, which is presented each year to a woman who has been instrumental in motivating and inspiring other women to explore recovery and seek recovery in any areas of their lives. This year, the She Recovers Foundation Hope Award was presented to Tarana Burke. Now she was, yeah, yes, woo! Now, she wasn't able to attend our GALA tonight, but she received the award last weekend in New York, and she has a beautiful message for us now.
Thank you so much to the She Recovers family. I want to give a special thanks to Dawn and Taryn for thinking of me for this amazing honor. The Me Too movement and She Recovers have so much in common. We share common values and a common ethos, particularly about recovery or healing, which is all in the same family. We do believe that healing is possible. We believe recovery is possible, and we believe it happens while in deep collaboration and cooperation with each other, in community with one another. And so I'm glad to be a part of the She Recovers family. I'm glad that you all thought of me in this moment, in this really critical historical moment that we're in. And I hope to be in collaboration and community with you in the future. Thank you so much again.
Please direct your attention to the screens for a short video about the She Recovers Foundation Legacy Award honoree.
I do not believe that being First Lady should prevent me from expressing my ideas. There are women all over the country like me, and if I don't make this public, then their lives will be gone. They're in jeopardy. And I think it did a great deal for women as far as the cancer problem is concerned.
Before Betty Ford, breast cancer was kind of a dirty little secret in America. Women didn't talk about it.
Why did you decide, Betty, to start the Betty Ford Center?
As I got into recovery, I had so many requests from so many people writing me, sending telegrams and calling, saying, how did you do it?
This country loved this woman. And the enormous respect and affection that they had for her just magnified the impact of her announcement. It brought home in a way that I'm not sure anything else could, that this disease could virtually touch any family in this country.
She's just Betty Ford person, and I'm facing up to my addiction, and I'm gonna beat this thing, and if I can beat it, you can beat it. What a role model, what a legacy.
Thank you for all you have done for women.
You've allowed so many women to seek treatment. All of your support for women's addiction treatment has been immensely valuable.
I'm just grateful that you were willing to come forward with your disease and to set up this program that has helped so many people after you.
She opened the door for women to seek treatment.
Please welcome actress, author, recovery advocate, counselor, and partner at Breathe Life Healing Center in West Hollywood, and strategic advisor to She Recovers, Mackenzie Phillips.
Thank you so much. Good evening, everybody. I now have the most amazing girl crush on Amy Dresner. I cannot begin to tell you how much I enjoyed what she had to say tonight. The She Recovers Foundation Legacy Award is presented each year to a woman who has primarily, through her willingness to recover out loud, been instrumental in reducing the stigma and shame surrounding women who are in or seeking recovery in any area of their lives. Now, having done away with the formalities, I would like to say that I am beyond honored to have this opportunity to present this award tonight to Susan Ford Bales on behalf of She Recovers Foundation. As I was tasked with coming up with something to say, I was like, what am I going to say? And then I went, speak your heart, Mac. Speak your heart. And that's what I have to remind myself every time I get up to the podium or on a stage to talk about my journey and my recovery. And I started thinking about women, alcoholism, addiction, mental illness, eating disorders, self-harm, and the shame and stigma and the certain lens through which people like me are viewed. Over time, throughout history, even in our basic text, the only time, really, and you know what I'm saying when I say our basic text, I'm not going to stand up here and break any traditions, but really there's one chapter, to the wives of the men who have the problem, right? The shame of the alcoholic woman. The shame of the addicted woman. I say no. I say I insist on recovering out loud. I say I insist on standing tall as a woman in long-term recovery. But I would not have the space, and nor would I have the legion of women standing behind me were it not for Betty Ford. Throughout time, in 1944, there was a woman named Marty Mann. God, I loved Marty Mann. I didn't know her, but man, she's like, man, I get it. Sorry, that's not funny, but it's kind of funny. She created NCAD, the National, well, it was called the National Committee for, right now it's not that anymore. The name has been changed, the National Committee on Alcoholism and Drug Dependency. And it is a, I think that's it, am I right? It's a national place that has chapters. It has chapters, Dawn, all over the country, right? She spoke out about the stigma attached to being a woman with alcoholism. I personally was treated in a place called Alina Lodge in Blairstown, New Jersey, for 9 long months, and it was run by a woman named Geraldine Owen Delaney. Now, when I met this woman, she was 45 years sober. She was 85 years old. She was friends with Bill W. and Lois. And so I think about this legion of women standing behind me. Mrs. Delaney opened Alina Lodge in 1957. But then it went really quiet. Shh. Don't talk about the alcoholic women. And then came this beacon of hope, this beam of light. Our First Lady, Betty Ford, had the cojones, the strength of character, to stand up and say another version of Me Too. I'm an alcoholic woman. And I will not let your lens that you are viewing me through stop me from recovering out loud and using my platform as the First Lady of the United States to further my agenda to bring hope for all of us here in this room. That is some powerful juju that woman had. And her legacy lives on. Now, people think, well, Mac, you've been in treatment so many times. 11, sidebar. People immediately assume that I went to Betty Ford Center. Somehow, I never did. I hit every other hot spot. But I never went to the Betty Ford Center. But I have been there in my capacity as the Director of Referral Relations at Breathe Life Healing Center here in West Hollywood. And I also was at Hausle and Betty Ford for a week-long professionals training event, and I had some quiet time alone, and I started walking the halls of this hallowed institution, which had merged with Betty Ford, hence the Hausle and Betty Ford Foundation. And I was walking down, because it's an enormous campus, and I was walking down this sunlit hallway, and there was a statue of Mrs. Ford, a bust, actually. And I had just such a watershed moment. This is gonna sound so weird, but I stroked her hair. I am not kidding. I thanked her and I gave her a kiss on the cheek because she paved the way for women like me. And women like all of us in this room, we are all recovering from something. And so it is with great joy and such a terrific honor to present this award tonight to Mr. and Mrs. Ford's daughter, Susan Ford Bales. Please come up, Susan.
Well, there's not much left to say. But thank you, Dawn and Taryn and Mac. I appreciate your very, very kind words about my mother. The Legacy Award means so much to my mother, Betty Ford, and I only wish she was here to do this and accept it. She recovered just over 40 years ago. And she started the Betty Ford Center just over 35 years ago. So thanks to our alumni and family and friends who continue to spread the word of recovery and hope and healing. And it is the strength of all of you in this room and our alumni, and especially women, who will continue to share that word and get rid of the stigma that is so horrible that we all still deal with. Yes, things have come a long way in the last 40 years, but we still have a long way to go. So thank you all very much for this award. Stay strong, give hope to others, and continue to share your stories. Thank you.
Welcome Liz Hausle, an unstoppable visionary and established music and entertainment executive. Liz spent 20 years in the entertainment business, holding executive positions at Jay-Z's Roc Nation, Columbia Records, and street label Loud Records.
Hi, everybody. Wow, it was such an honor to be here tonight. And yes, everybody looks absolutely beautiful. What an incredible day today. Let's also give it up for Don Dorothy and Taryn Strong and the She Recovers team for their dedication, commitment. Yeah, incredible. So we have a gifted musical performer tonight, Ester Nicholson. She's a celebrated vocalist, teacher, and author of Soul Recovery, 12 Keys to Healing Dependence, a process that Ester Nicholson developed to heal herself of a life-threatening crack cocaine addiction. This process unifies the 12-step recovery with universally accepted spiritual practices and has guided thousands to their recovery and higher purpose. With 32 years of sobriety, right? She is living her vision of serving others in their journey from crisis and challenge to a new fulfilled life. The Oprah Winfrey Network featured her life story, and she has graced the stages of Madison Square Garden and other global arenas with iconic artists, including Beyonce, Barbara Streisand, Bette Midler, and Rod Stewart. Ladies and gentlemen, get ready for a powerful performance and experience by the beautiful and sexy Ester Nicholson.
Good evening. So this is a song that we're going to sing to each other, yes? Here we go.
Looking out on the morning rain, I used to feel so uninspired, and when I knew I had to face another day, Lord, you made me feel so tired. Before the day I I met you, life was so unkind. You're the key to my peace of mind. You make me feel, you make me feel, you make me feel like a natural woman. When my thoughts were in the lost and found, you came along to claim it. I didn't know just what was wrong with me till your love helped me name it. Now I'm no longer doubtful of what I'm living for, and if I make you happy, I don't need to do more. So you, can you sing that? You make me feel like a natural woman. Oh, baby, what you done for me? You make me feel so good inside. Just wanna be close to you. You make me feel so alive. Said you make me feel, you make me feel like a natural woman. Let's do it again, come on.
That in record time. So that's pretty amazing. So we actually do have some time before the silent disco starts, I believe. It starts at 9, so you guys can freshen up and do some things. But we just want to take a moment and thank you all.
Dawn.
How did I get here to this moment? You know, 31 years ago, a little bit of my story, very, very little bit, I was a cocaine addict. I did a lot of pills, drank a lot of things. And I was 27 years old, and I had known from the time that I was 17 that I had a problem with substances. And one day, this very beautiful little girl who was at the time 6 years old, not this one, she was only two, we were in the living room of our house on the Sunshine Coast in British Columbia, where we live, and Taryn was thirsty. She needed something to drink. Ashley was six, and she was watching Sesame Street. And Mama was lying on the couch, dying with the hangover and not having slept for a number of days. I was just really ill. And I was asking Ashley to please just go and get your sister a bottle. Were you drinking a bottle still then? I don't know. Get her some juice. I think it was a bottle. She was a late bloomer. She's made up for it since. And so my moment of clarity in my life and what brought me here to this point, to be here, a woman in long-term recovery with a daughter in recovery, was that I was begging my six-year-old to do the thing that I should have got up and done myself as a mom. And I said, please, Ashley, just do it, please. I'm sick. I'm so sick, Ashley. I'm sick, and I need you to do this for me. And her beautiful, beautiful little blonde-haired, big-eye thing came up to where I was lying out on the couch. And she just got right up in my face. And I said, please, Ashley, I'm really sick. And she said, Mommy, you make me sick. I know. If you don't go to treatment after that, there's something wrong with you, right? So I did go to treatment, and here we are today. And I mean, I just talk about... The other part of our story is, I'm sorry, it's kind of an interesting time to be this person, but I am a U.S. political news junkie. I've always been fascinated with American politics, with all of the presidents. It's okay. And I've just always loved Betty Ford. And so, to be here tonight, to have the capacity within this room that we have of talent and strength and imagination and creativity is just beyond our wildest dreams. I think it's just a magnificent moment for us, for me personally, for my beautiful daughter. Excuse me. So I want to thank you. Thank you all for being here. And I want to tell you, this is the one thing that I actually came out here to say, and I've rambled on now, but Lisa McCubbin has written a book that was literally released on Tuesday about Betty Ford. It's being sold at the Hausle Book Nook. I believe that Susan Ford Bales has signed some of the copies. I think it's probably, there's been many books written, but I've had a little look at this one before, and it looks like it's amazing. So I do encourage you to get the book. Please help continue to honor her legacy, not just through this legacy award. Please keep loving each other. Please keep doing everything that we're doing. Come back tomorrow. It's not over. Taryn?
I didn't know we were speaking.
Well, I didn't either. Made it up.
Great. Yes. Yes. Well, thank you so much for being here and trusting us with your big open hearts. And I do just have to acknowledge that, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for this woman and Mama Dawn. So thank you for loving her up. I love sharing her with all of you. And since we're sharing a little bit of our stories, I'll share just a quick little bit about mine, in that a lot of people are surprised to hear, because I grew up with a mom in recovery and with parents in recovery, that I'm also in recovery. And I know for a fact that if it wasn't for my mom having been in recovery, I wouldn't be here for a lot of reasons, but having a mom in recovery is what helped steer me back on that path when I was 16 and addicted to cocaine and meth and ran away with the crack dealer. Don't recommend it, but what I know is that this woman, I knew that she loved me unconditionally, and there was never any shame. When things got really, really scary really quickly, I knew that I could go home, and I knew that I was gonna be okay. And my mom had her recovery, she had her tools, but most importantly, and this is the point of why I'm sharing this, she had her community of her recovery women, that when I was off doing my thing, living with the crack dealer, she had her network of women helping her get through it. So thank you all for being here. We are all family now, and thank you for just being here with your big hearts, like I already said. And this community, we're stuck with each other now. We always say this at things. You go to something and it's really life-changing and it's really transformative. You're like, oh, we're going to keep in touch. Give me your email. I can't wait to keep in touch. And you never see that person again. That doesn't happen at She Recovers Things. So you're stuck with us. All of you are stuck with us. And I couldn't be prouder to have you all here.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes. Yeah. So thank you to all our wonderful presenters, and thank you, Susan, for coming all this way. We really appreciate it. And we're going to do a whole bunch more of this stuff tomorrow, but first, we dance.